Please be seated. As Chancellor of the University, I declare this congregation open for the conferring of degrees by the authority of the Senate and of the Council.
As Vice Chancellor, I am delighted to welcome you all to this degree congregation. It is a celebration for all those who graduate today. We celebrate your many achievements that culminate in the award of a degree from a major international research and teaching-led university. While you have been with us, the university has developed and changed. We are now a community of 19,000 students and 3,000 staff with a turnover of £200 million. We are a big business with higher education at its heart. The university has celebrated its 50th anniversary this academic year. It is a major milestone, and we have reflected this in many events, including these degree ceremonies, where we are awarding honorary degrees to several people who are closely connected to us. This academic year, we have been proud of a number of achievements. Leicester's research grants have increased by more than 50% to £54 million of income, which places us within the top 20 of UK's top research-intensive universities. Leicester's research has been shown to have the greatest impact of any Midlands university, and placed 10th in terms of impact in England by an independent survey conducted in conjunction with the Guardian newspaper. In June, Leicester was named as one of just 7 institutions to lead a £20 million National Institute for Health Research. The university is one of 10 institutions specially selected to lead on engaging employers through the provision of flexible, bespoke education for employees. Applications for undergraduate places at Leicester rose by 17% for this autumn's 2008 entry. And the synergy between teaching and research is nowhere better represented than in the university's new £32 million library, which we were very proud to open in April, that brings together exciting space for undergraduates, postgraduates, and staff. I do recommend that those of you who are here go and have a look at the library before you go home. I'm assuming, of course, that all our graduands have looked at the library many times in the last 3 or 4 years and spent many happy hours there. Now, all of these achievements contribute to Leicester's league table position. Leicester was placed in 12th position in the Independent's Good University Guide. It was placed in 14th position in The Guardian this May, and in June, The Times also put us in 14th place. Now, I've very carefully checked the data for these tables, and I'm sure that you will agree with me that the Independent's table is by far the most reliable this year. But what contributes to our league table position? In the last year, Leicester staff have engaged in many leading activities. In the Faculty of Law, a number of books have been published, including Professor David Bonner's Executive Measures, Terrorism and National Security, Professor Mark Bell's Cases, Materials and Text on National, Supranational and International Non-Discrimination Law. Professor Mads Andinas will spend part of each year as Director of the Norwegian Centre for Human Rights in the University of Oslo for the next 3 years. In addition, law students have been shortlisted for awards in 2 categories in the Attorney General's Student and Law School Pro Bono Awards, which recognise significant achievement in pro bono work. and the memory of the department's founding professor, Jan Gradecki, was honoured by the official naming and opening of the Jan Gradecki Room earlier this academic year. Now, in order to support the work of our staff and students, we have developed high-quality facilities. In the past 3 years, we have completed a number of projects totaling a capital spend of around £70 million. These have included the £32 million library refurbishment, which doubled the size of the university library and also provided us with a new 500-seat lecture theatre, I suspect to be predominantly used by the Faculty of Law. Opening of the £23 million John Foster Hall took place earlier this academic year, providing 581 study bedrooms and refurbished facilities for students in a facilities block. We have spent £2 million on refurbishing and improving a number of laboratories over in the medical school, and as you will see when you go on the campus, we are nearing completion of the cleaning and repair of the external facade of the Attenborough Tower, which is part of a £2.2 million full window replacement programme. Nevertheless, there is no shortage of projects for the next capital programme. These include a £15 million refurbishment of the Percy G Students' Union building, which we aim to commence next academic year to give the Students' Union a facility where you will say, wow, just like you do on the when you go in the university library. We are going to construct further teaching space. We're engaged in an energy conservation programme against the around the campus in order to improve our carbon footprint. And a new development framework plan provides a framework for what the University of Leicester will look like in the next 5, 10, 15 and 20 years. It is absolutely essential that we move forward in this dynamic way. Now, if the figures in the plan are to be believed, then we will be investing another £786 million in the next 10 to 20 years. So I hope if you've got any suggestions for fundraising, you will leave them with us at the end of the afternoon. We make a significant contribution to the community that comes in many forms, but I am always very proud to hear of the volunteering work that students do alongside their academic and social lives. This year, 2,500 students have been in voluntary activities in the community. In particular, Contact, our student volunteering organisation, has been involved in a whole range of projects, which include charitable events, it involves digging allotments, it involves taking children on holiday. But the one that attracts a lot of interest is the Right to Read scheme, where over 4 years, 278 students have volunteered in 40 city and county primary schools, projects and after-school clubs. The children that have taken part in these projects will never forget the contribution you have made. You empower them, you change their lives by your voluntary activity. Our work as a university never stops. We are creating plans for new research, new teaching programmes and new community links. It all demonstrates we are a dynamic university. However, any university requires multi-million pound investments for new buildings, laboratories, classrooms, equipment, and this university is no exception. Over the past 3 years, Leicester will have invested over £80 million in its estate. This has been funded by our own funds, government grants, loans, and donations. It is absolutely essential that government continues to fund universities in order to transform them. The last 10 years has witnessed massive investment into UK universities, and I think we can see the direct benefits in terms of the quality of the research, the quality of teaching, and the way in which standards go ever higher. You can be very proud to have a degree from any UK university. You should certainly be proud to have a degree from this university. But the funding needs to be placed alongside our own fundraising. And I hope you will wish to continue to support your university in many different ways through our Alumni Association. We hope you will keep in touch with us, and I shall look forward to meeting you all at alumni events. Finally, I would like to congratulate you all on the degrees you have obtained. But before I close, I'd like to tell you about a competition that we run between the faculties every year. It's become known as the Vice Chancellor's Competition. Basically, we see which faculty can applaud longest and loudest in all the degree ceremonies. Now, I think the Faculty of Law have got a great advantage this year. You're on first, which is the first occasion for years. So you can set the standard this afternoon, and I should be able to say the following days, well, you know, you're going to be pretty lucky in arts or social science to match the lawyers. So will you join with me in showing your appreciation to your parents, relatives, friends, and sponsors who have supported you through the university? So I would now ask the graduating class of 2008 to join me in a round of applause for all those people. That's very good. Have a really enjoyable afternoon. Applaud your fellow students, and all good wishes to you in your future careers.
The Most Reverend Vincent Nichols is the Roman Catholic Archbishop of Birmingham, the eighth person to rejoice in that title since the diocese was raised to metropolitan status in 1911. He was born in Crosby, near Liverpool, and retains an allegiance to his home region, but he is also an old Roman, which is to say a product of the venerable English College in Rome, to which generations of the most promising English candidates for the priesthood have been sent. While the Venerabile took care of his priestly formation, his theological studies were undertaken at the Pontifical Gregorian University, affectionately known as the Greg. He was ordained deacon in 1968 and priest in 1969, and so will shortly mark 40 years of priestly ministry. After ordination and the completion of his studies in Rome, his formal education continued. On return to England, he studied at the University of Manchester and later at Loyola University in Chicago. Now, for his MA from Manchester, he wrote a thesis on the theology of John Fisher, the 16th century English bishop who was martyred for his faith. And while it could be said that the life of any bishop involves daily martyrdoms, there are more obvious analogies to be made between Vincent Nichols and John Fisher. Like the subject of his thesis, Archbishop Vincent is unswervingly orthodox in communicating the teachings of the church and does not flinch from commenting on the moral and spiritual dimensions of public and political life. Like Fisher, he is a conscientious pastoral bishop, but he uses distinctly 21st century means to convey his message. In 2003, for example, he made headlines by undertaking a sponsored cycle ride right across his diocese from the north of Staffordshire to the south of Oxfordshire. If I may pursue the Fisher analogy in one other respect, it is in order to emphasize Vincent Nichols' commitment to the cause of Catholic education. For the 16th century bishop was Chancellor for Life of the University of Cambridge. Archbishop Nichols speaks with authority on educational matters, not least because between 1972 and 1977 he was a chaplain at St. John Rigby Sixth Form College in Wigan. From 1981 to 84 as director of the Upholland Institute, he gained experience of the adult education sector. Now, during those years in the Liverpool Archdiocese, Vincent Nichols acted as an advisor to Archbishop Derek Warlock, whose influence helped to secure his appointment as General Secretary of the Catholic Bishops' Conference of England and Wales. It was a post that he held from 1984 to 1991 and indicated that he was now on course for episcopal promotion. That duly followed when in 1991 and at the age of 46, he was appointed as an auxiliary bishop in the Archdiocese of Westminster with responsibility for North London. And in early 2000, he was translated to Birmingham. Archbishop Vincent has published a number of books of a pastoral nature, most recently Missioners, Priest and People Today, published last year. Of more widespread impact has been the series of booklets for Advent and Lent initiated and inspired by him. Under the title Walk With Me, the booklets provide thoughtful material for daily prayer and meditation. The Lenten series are regularly taken up by 250,000 people. But it is through other media that he is perhaps even better known. His fluency as a speaker, which may well be a reflection of his Liverpudlian origins, has led him to providing several thoughts for the day for Radio 4 listeners. But it was his contribution to the BBC's coverage of the funeral of Pope John Paul II and the election of Pope Benedict XVI in 2005 that made him something of a television celebrity. He was generally and rightly acknowledged to be a natural for television. While it is the responsibility of every bishop to teach his flock, education in a more formal sense continues to loom large in Archbishop Nichols' CV. He is chairman of the Catholic Education Service and of the Department for Catholic Education and Formation of the Bishops' Conference of England and Wales. In this position, he leads contact and negotiation with the government on all matters of Catholic schools and colleges. He's also the principal episcopal trustee of the three remaining English seminaries outside the United Kingdom, the Venerable English College in Rome, the Pontifical Beda College in Rome, and the Royal English College in Valladolid. Within his diocese, he is president of Merivale Institute at Oscott and chairman of the governing body of Newman University College in Birmingham, whose degrees were until recently validated by University of Leicester. When the arrangement with Newman was established, our Vice Chancellor met the governors, and the chairman of those governors, Archbishop Vincent, asked questions that were characteristically penetrating and exceedingly well-informed. Mr. Chancellor, on the recommendation of the Senate and of the Council, I present to you Archbishop Vincent Nichols, that you may confer upon him the degree of Doctor of Letters.
Sir, I admit you to the degree of Doctor of Letters. Congratulations.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Chancellor, Lord Mayor of the City of Leicester, fellow graduands, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great honour for me this afternoon to receive this honorary degree from the University, and I'm very grateful to the Chancellor and the authorities of the University for giving this to me today. It's a wonderful day for the life of you who are to receive degrees that you've earned, rather than, like me, receive a degree as a gift. And I would like to congratulate all those who are to graduate today on their years of study and the achievement of their exams. I'd like to offer, if I may, just one word, one phrase, which I hope you will keep in mind as your careers and your lives flourish. The phrase is this: the human spirit soars on the wings of reason and faith. Our spirits soar when faith and reason beat together and raise us to the heights of the potential that is in us. For a minute, the implications of that. We live in an age in which faith can be controversial. I would say to you, be suspicious of anyone who says to you that the demands of faith excuse it from reason. Faith must always be challenged by reason, and indeed refined under that challenge and give a coherent account of itself. But equally, be suspicious of those who tell you that you can achieve all you want simply by the path of reason. We live in an age of secular rationality, and that's fine, but it is never the whole story. And do not believe those who tell you that we are simply rational beings with no spiritual heart within us. Faith and reason, the two wings on which your spirits can soar. And I hope that phrase will stay with you as you leave the university today, full of pride and proper pride at your achievement. As Archbishop of Birmingham, I'd like to say a final word of gratitude to the University of Leicester for the great help that they have given to Newman University College. As chairman of the governors of that college, we are proud of our association with this University of Leicester and very grateful for the work that the two colleges can do together. Chancellor, I thank you very much indeed for this honor that you bestowed upon me today.
Graduates in the Faculty of Law, represented by the Dean, Professor Bonner, will all graduates in the Faculty please stand?
Mr. Chancellor, I ask you to admit these candidates from the Faculty of Law to the several degrees for which they are presented.
Graduates in the Faculty of Law, I admit you to the several degrees for which you are presented.
For the degree of Doctor of Philosophy, Jonathan McQuarrie. For the degree of Master of Laws in European Union Law Commercial, Angeliki Agathokleos. Richard Bryden. C. Chan, Yana Haber, Susan Pages, Serhi Perimo, John Sigurdsson. For the degree of Master of Laws in European Union Law Employment, James Darrow. Michel Gabay, Fleming Martinussen, Paul O'Neill. For the degree of Master of Laws in Law and Employment Relations, Adobea Addo, Victoria Best. Stephanie Blythe, Michael Boyle, Nicola Brandwood, Jeff Brown, Karen Cheney, Susan Crowan, Daniel Gilmore, Karina Leonard, Louise Lindsay, Marina Meehan, Leslie Murphy, Ronald Roberts, Joanne Shorrocks, Claire Sykes, Gordon West, Sarah Whittam, Robert Wilkes, Maxine Winnie, Kate Wyatt. For the degree of Bachelor of Laws in Law, Khadija Abbas, Sarah Arger, Fahin Ahmad, Sadia Akhtar, Iftikhar Ali, Rebecca Allen, Nadia Alibi, Irene Antonopoulos, Ayodeji Anubi, Jenny Armitage, winner of the Cavendish Prize, Claire Arthur, Rukeya Azaim, Daljinder Bajwa, Philip Baldwin, Sophie Barker, winner of the Faculty of Law Prize, David Barrett, Nicola Bartholomew, Zainab Barta, Joanna Bettis, winner of the Harvey Ingram LLP Law of Tort Prize, Thomas Bainham, Donna Bishop, Janice Black, Bukola Bolarinwa, winner of the Oxford University Press Law Prize and the Herbert Smith Prize, Jonathan Bowden, Holly Bowery, Simon Breeden, Qatar Bring, James Brown, Oliver Butler, John Byrne, winner of the Chambers of Michael Pert QC Prize and the George Heim Memorial Trust Prize, James Carter, Gurgit Chahal,
what have you had?
Jeffrey Chan, Eliana Haralambous, Tiffany Chatterton, Amanda Cherrington, Simone Chung, Joyce Chiang, Olympios Christofi, Nawalaje Kure, winner of the Freshfields Brookhouse Derringer Mooting Prizes and the Herbert Smith Debating Competition Prizes, Curtis Couch. Paul Crofts. Tara Dalton. Laura Daly. Emily Danson. Sophie Davis. Rajvinder Dotha. Brett Ducker. Laura Dunlop. Winner of the Claire Nicholson Memorial Prize, Samantha Edwards. Zakelina Erotokritu. Charlotte Evans. Philip Evans. Richard Ferguson. Amy Ferraby. Kula Feely. Charlotte Flashman. Jonathan Flattery. Adrian Ford. Harriet Frankos. Caroline Frost. Elena Gabriel. Chanel Gale. Anna Georgiou. Charlianne Gilhini. Rajvir Gurn. Winner of the House Percival Prize, the May Fund Prize, and the Department of Law Prize, Nicola Godden.
Well done.
Gerald Goh.
Well done.
Hui Ping Go. Amy Goodman. Thomas Gorard Smith. Christiana Haji Anastasiou. Mirofora Haji Mateo. Winner of the Morgan Cole Company Law Prize, Lawrence Hagen. Danielle Haken. Natasha Hayward. Eleanor Hodgkiss. Rachel Holland. Peter Horwell. Junaid Hussein. Nadia Hussein. Arzu Hussein. Alkisti Yakavu. Antonia Jackson. Dylan Jacobs. Rizwana Jamal. Prabjit Jammu. Gianni Gia. Brenda Giacomo. Gareth Jones. Jackie Jones. James Jordan. Joshua Canarkham. Eleni Karatsalidou, Maria Kataliaku, Amarjit Kaur, Hardeep Kaur, Sarah Kerr, winner of the Peter Kavanagh Trophy, the Herbert Smith Debating Competition Prizes, and the Freshfields Brookhouse Derringer Mooting Prizes, Daniel Kerrigan. Winner of the Sweeten Maxwell Prize and the Leicestershire Law Society Prize, Kashmala Khan.
Congratulations.
Sarah Katoon. George Kirui.
Well done, George. Congratulations.
On May the 15th this year, Councillor Manjula Sood was installed as Lord Mayor of the City of Leicester. Leicester has had a Lord Mayor since 1928, when it was awarded the status of a city, but the office of Mayor of Leicester goes back to 1209. In this 800th year of the office, Manjula Sood is the 550th Mayor. Our numerate graduands will of course realise from these figures that several people have held the office more than once. She is the first female Asian to be first citizen of Leicester, or indeed mayor of any town in England. Later this week, attired in the black and gold mayoral robes, she will watch and applaud as other degrees are awarded by our Chancellor. Today, we are proud to honour her. It is perhaps fortunate that she has chosen not to wear her robes today. They are very similar to those worn by the Chancellor, albeit with a much better hat, and confusion would be regrettable. Manjula Sood was born in Ludhiana in northern India, where she received her education at the Jain High School and Government College. Ludhiana is the largest city in the Indian Punjab. It is a major centre of the knitwear and hosiery industries and is known as the Manchester of the Punjab. This is, of course, a misnomer. The centre of the British knitwear and hosiery industries was, and is, Leicester, and not some damp and dismal northern city. Ludhiana is the Leicester of the Punjab. Manjula Sood went on to the University of the Punjab at Chandigarh, the beautiful city which is the capital of Punjab state. There she received her BA in English and Politics and MA with distinction in Sociology. She also began a PhD project in association with Johns Hopkins University in the United States, but marriage and the move to Leicester prevented its completion. Manjula Sood arrived in a cold and snowy Leicester in December 1970. The change was so dramatic that she wanted to return home. She telephoned her grandfather, an army veteran, and he told her, "Leicester is your home. I have given you education. Go and get some training and find a job." This she did. From January 1971, she trained as a primary school teacher at this university, the university which her aunt had previously attended. In January 1973, she joined East Park Primary School, teaching there for 12 years before moving to Spinney Hills Primary School. When she started teaching, Leicester was struggling to absorb some 20,000 Ugandan Asian refugees, and Mrs. Sood's Asian background and teaching skills greatly helped the children of many of these refugees to adapt to their new life. She was a pioneer in multicultural education in the city and the county, and was recognised as such in a meeting with Prince Charles. In 1991, she was forced to retire from teaching due to ill health, taking on the management of a travel agency. In 1996, Manjula Sood's life changed again in tragic circumstances. Her husband, Paul, died suddenly. Paul Sood had served as a city councillor since 1982, and his widow, who had long been active in the local Labour Party, was asked to succeed him. At the by-election, she was duly elected as councillor for the Abbey Ward, representing it until 2003. In that year, she was elected councillor for the Latimer Ward, which includes the Belgrave Road, Leicester's Golden Mile. As a long-serving city councillor, Manjula Sood has served on many major council committees. She was vice chair of the committees on education, health and social services, and later chair of the Health Commission. Before becoming Lord Mayor, she was the cabinet lead for health and well-being. She is a trustee of the North Memorial Homes in Leicester, a charity which provides accommodation for war veterans. She also chaired the women's project Nari Let's, which inspires women to exchange skills and is supported by the Heritage Lottery Fund. Manjula Sood was awarded the Labour Party Merit Award in 2004 and was voted the Leicestershire and Rutland Woman of the Year in 2006. The Lord Mayor's appeal this year is in aid of the Special Olympics National Games, which will be held in Leicester in July 2009. These Special Games provide an opportunity for those with learning disabilities to demonstrate their strengths, and some 4,000 people are expected to come here to be a part of them. Leicester is the only city to host the UK Special Olympics twice, and I commend the appeal to you. Manjula Sood is a trustee and an executive director of the Leicester Council of Faiths and has been a member of the UK Interfaith Network since 1995. The civic service held to mark her appointment was held in the cathedral, one of whose canons is a close friend, and she has also appointed a Hindu spiritual advisor. Manjula Sood has come a long way. 5,000 miles from the Leicester of the Punjab to Leicester in the United Kingdom. From a cold, snowy December as a young wife to a warm, warmish July as first citizen of her adopted city. From a student of this university to its honorary graduand. Mr. Chancellor, on the recommendation of the Senate and of the Council, I present Manjula Sood that you may confer on her the honorary degree of Doctor of Laws.
Chancellor, Vice Chancellor, Pro-Chancellors, fellow honoured dignitaries, all graduates, ladies and gentlemen, what a great honour to stand here and receive Honorary Degree, Doctor of Laws. This was something, a dream which I never ever thought when I arrived here in Leicester. My dream when I came here to join my husband was to start a new life. And in that life, as I have been told, it was extremely cold and I didn't want to stay here. On the telling of my granddad, to prove to him, I just walked around the streets of Leicester and the first building which came was School of Education on University Road. And that's where the first chapter of my dream was written. And thank you, Chancellor, for giving me that opportunity in 1970, that made my destiny. And since that day, I didn't look back. This university gave me skills, qualification, knowledge, so that I could make something with my life. And it has been a great honor to serve the city of Leicester, and Leicester is a great, vibrant city. Anybody who comes here loves this city, they don't want to go back. It's just the beauty of this multicultural city. And sitting here when I was looking at all of you, those graduates, this reminded me of my time, that in 1971, how proud I was about myself. And this is what I'm going to tell you today. From here, you are going to go into the wider world. You will be making your own destiny, but never give up on your dreams, because somewhere, somehow, they will come true. Have your self-confidence, empower yourself, but at the same time, look after your health as well, and never forget your roots, where you were, and your parents, and your tutors, who have given you this lovely life and this qualification. And I would like to say a big thank you to my two sons, Manish, Mitesh, my daughter-in-law, and my mom, who have been a great part of my journey, and all the citizens of Leicester. And my dream, you can see, from Leicester University to be the first citizen of the city and to make a history, to be the first Asian female Lord Mayor in Britain. If I can achieve it, you all can achieve it. Thank you, Lord Chancellor, for this.
The remaining graduates in the faculty will now be presented by the Dean, Professor Bonner.
For the degree of Bachelor of Laws in Law, Joseph Kitchingham.
Congratulations.
Alina Kolatu.
Congratulations.
Kirandi Kumar.
Congratulations.
Maria Kiprianu.
Congratulations.
Natalie Kiprianu.
Congratulations.
Eliza Kiriaku.
Congratulations.
Michelle Lally.
Congratulations.
Emily Lawrence.
Congratulations.
Hanyang Lin.
Congratulations.
Sonia Lonsdale.
Congratulations.
Sarah Lun.
Congratulations.
Maria Matteo.
Congratulations.
Michael Matthews.
Congratulations.
Stacy Matthews.
Congratulations.
Anna McArdle.
Congratulations.
Helen McHugh.
Congratulations.
Lauren McLean.
Congratulations.
Nicholas McQueen.
Congratulations.
Mohammed Mir.
Congratulations.
Charlotte Myers.
Congratulations.
Artemis Milidoni.
Congratulations.
Theodora Miltiadu.
Congratulations.
Zara Mohammed.
Congratulations.
Anne Marie Monteith.
Congratulations.
Lucy Morris.
Congratulations.
Sophia Mukadam.
Congratulations.
Alastair Mundy.
Congratulations.
Nicola Murray-Smith.
Congratulations.
Azra Musa.
Congratulations.
Manaka Muthu Palianyapan.
Congratulations.
Winner of the Roger Benedictus Memorial Prize in Employment Law, Claire Nash.
Congratulations, Bye-bye,
Ulas Nazim.
Congratulations.
William Neal.
Congratulations.
Bethany Nevitt.
Congratulations.
Demetris Nicolaou.
Congratulations.
Aaron Noble.
Congratulations.
Adedemola Omoyeni.
Congratulations.
Christine Uma.
Congratulations.
Amanda Haddock.
Congratulations.
Georgia Pamboris.
Congratulations. Thank you.
Loretta Papakonstantinou.
Congratulations.
Omiros Papakonstantinou.
Congratulations.
Primesh Patel.
Congratulations.
Saga Patel.
Congratulations.
Winner of the Sweeten Maxwell Law Prize, Shyam Patel.
Congratulations, well done on your prize.
Vishal Patel.
Congratulations.
Kanika Paul.
Congratulations.
Danielle Penny.
Congratulations.
Kylie Perrin.
Congratulations.
Megan Phillips.
Congratulations.
Davin Pindoria.
Congratulations.
Eva Polaskaridou.
Congratulations.
Cora Pratt.
Congratulations.
Panayiota Protopapa.
Congratulations.
Winner of the Linklaters Prize, Sonia Punia.
Congratulations.
Winner of the Herbert Smith Debating Competition Prizes and the John Holyoake Prize, Rakibu Rahman.
Congratulations, well done on your prizes.
Vivek Raja.
Congratulations.
Catherine Raybould.
Congratulations.
William Reynolds.
Congratulations.
Matthew Rice.
Congratulations.
Dale Roberts.
Congratulations.
Nicholas Rutter.
Congratulations.
Mohammed Saeed.
Congratulations.
Carmel Salvage.
Congratulations.
Abdul Sami.
Congratulations.
Ian Saunders.
Congratulations.
David Schofield.
Congratulations.
Thomas Scott.
Congratulations.
Ashley Seeley.
Congratulations.
Ateisi Secondus.
Congratulations.
Benjamin Sedler.
Congratulations.
Nitu Sedev.
Congratulations.
Natasha Sharma.
Congratulations.
Alice Simpson.
Congratulations.
Winner of the Herbert Smith Prize, the Oxford University Press Law Prize, the Clyde & Co Prize in Competition Law, and the Jan Gradecki Conflict of Laws Prize, Dmitry Shirovicha.
Very well done on all the prizes.
Winner of the Harvey Ingram LLP Law of Contract Prize, Rachel Skirm.
Congratulations, well done on your prize.
Winner of the Eversheds Commercial Law Prize, Amy Smith.
Congratulations, well done on your prize.
Crystal Sorkin.
Congratulations.
Alicia Sula.
Congratulations.
Renora Stanley.
Congratulations.
Theokaria Stavrou.
Congratulations.
Corinne Stevens.
Congratulations.
Michael Stewart.
Congratulations.
Joseph Stoker.
Congratulations.
Sally Tan.
Congratulations.
Amarjit Tind.
Congratulations.
Sophie Thomas.
Congratulations.
Lauren Thompson.
Congratulations.
Juliana Tolan.
Congratulations.
Leanne Townsend.
Congratulations.
Mariana Sangari.
Congratulations.
Craig Umblager.
Congratulations.
Amish Unka.
Congratulations.
David Wincup.
Congratulations.
Victoria Williams.
Congratulations.
Claire Wilson.
Congratulations.
Vincent Young.
Congratulations.
For the degree of Bachelor of Laws in Law, European Union, Charles Boyne.
Congratulations.
Lawrence de Glossop.
Congratulations.
Deepa Devlukia.
Congratulations.
Chloe Gill.
Congratulations.
Winner of the Eversheds Commercial Law Prize, Neil Grant.
Congratulations, well done on your prize.
Samuel McGinty.
Congratulations.
Vinesh Sharma.
Congratulations.
For the degree of Bachelor of Laws in Law International, Stacey Burton.
Congratulations, thank you.
Winner of the Peter Kavanagh Trophy, Heather Everett.
Congratulations, well done on your prize.
Kimberly Ferguson.
Congratulations.
Winner of the Chambers of Francis Oldham QC Prize, Rebecca Lewis.
Congratulations, well done on your prize.
Jonathan Richards.
Congratulations.
Jennifer Rigby.
Congratulations.
For the degree of Bachelor of Laws in Law with French Law and Language, Matthew Anderson.
Congratulations.
Karishma Bonji.
Congratulations.
Danielle Chichek.
Congratulations.
James Dent.
Congratulations.
Winner of the Brian Dodds Memorial Prize, Sean Harrison.
Congratulations, well done on your prize.
Chirag Rao.
Congratulations.
Laura Rickman.
Congratulations.
Priyadevi Thacker.
Congratulations.
Winner of the Freeth Cartwright LLP Law with French Prize, Kate Wilson.
Congratulations, well done on your prize.
For the degree of Bachelor of Laws in Law, Maîtrise, Céline Bouafia.
Congratulations.
Elizabeth Cleaver.
Congratulations.
Winner of the Franco-British Lawyer Society LLB Maîtrise Prize, James Peters.
Congratulations, well done on your prize.
Audrey Purcell O'Dwyer.
Congratulations.
James Wilson.
Congratulations.
For the degree of Bachelor of Laws in Law Senior Status, Gillian Alley.
Congratulations.
Nehru Ball.
Congratulations.
Agathy Christodoulidi.
Congratulations.
Navnit Dillon.
Congratulations.
Nipa Ghosh.
Congratulations.
Jaspreet Johal.
Congratulations. Thank you.
Hassan Junaid.
Congratulations.
Megan King.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ruth Cochibrocci.
Congratulations.
Nitu Malhotra.
Congratulations.
Justin Myers.
Congratulations.
Noorin Murji.
Congratulations.
Sonali Sharma.
Congratulations.
Marina Stilianu.
Congratulations.
Amit Vig.
Congratulations.
Ganashri Wood. Mr. Vice-Chancellor, I ask you to admit to the several degrees for which they are presented by my faculty those candidates who are absent.
By the authority of the Senate, I admit those candidates who are absent to the several degrees for which they are presented.
My Lord Mayor, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, can I first of all echo the Vice-Chancellor's comments earlier and add my own warm welcome to every one of you here today. This is above all, as you will have heard from that thunderous round of applause, a day for celebration. And I don't intend to detain you long from either that celebration or the temporary onset of English summer, which has appeared blessfully this afternoon. But can I begin my few words by adding my warm congratulations to our two honorary graduates today. The tapestry of your lives laid before us so eloquently by the two orators this afternoon truly provides an inspiration to every one of us here today, especially to our younger graduates this afternoon. You both do us great honor in accepting our awards today. And as I say, you are above all a wonderful, wonderful role model and example to the young. Thank you both so much. Turning then to all of you who have graduated today, I'm struck by the fact that it's only on these occasions, these ceremonies, at the University of Leicester, when I'm ever confronted by such a phalanx of emerging legal talent. I use the word phalanx advisedly because I am temporarily unsure of the collective noun for a group of lawyers. You may have some ideas, a confliction of lawyers, perhaps. I also use the words emerging legal talent advisedly, as I hope your tutors have explained that as you leave today clutching your degree certificate, you are at but the start of a journey into the legal profession, into whatever branch of the law you ultimately choose to practice. So may I wish you well on that journey as you leave Leicester and head forth. The names of many of the illustrious prizes that many of you have won this afternoon are, of course, famous city names from the City of London. And it could well be that many of you here today are lured by the financial markets and all that goes on in that wonderful place. If so, I draw your attention to the immortal words of Charles Dickens in Bleak House. The one great principle of the English law is to make business for itself. I've spent much of my own career in publicly listed industries, and I've spent many a happy hour in the company of leading corporate lawyers in the City of London. They have undoubtedly read Dickens, each and every one of them. However, before you go dreaming of those telephone book fee statements which you will be writing in the years to come, can I remind you that your immediate future as a junior, be it in chambers, a city law firm, or wherever, are arduous to say the least. All of my years dealing with your brethren, I've yet to meet a single corporate lawyer who can complete a major corporate transaction other than between the hours of midnight and 4 a.m. Mark my words, you will remember them in the years to come. Others among you, of course, may opt for legal practice in a more rural and relaxed and regional setting, and that's no bad thing. I play golf regularly with my corporate lawyer in Oxford, and a pleasurable occasion it is. I note his diary entry somewhat cryptically reads client engagement. So there is much to be said for pursuing that branch of your profession. Many of you, of course, as is clearly described in the degrees you've earned today, will practice internationally in Europe or much further afield. And wherever you practice, you've chosen the right university to study law. We, I hope, have equipped you with those powers of reason and logic and thinking which the Archbishop commented on earlier. Because wherever you practice your profession, whichever branch of the law you choose ultimately to specialize in, you are now bound together by one fundamental and underlying obligation. As lawyers, the rest of us in society will look to you to be the upholders of what is often referred to as the rule of law, the fundamental principles which guarantee personal freedoms and rights. Now, this is indeed an onerous responsibility that you share and assume. And we see all too frequent examples of what can happen in societies where these fundamental principles are brushed aside. If you'd learned one lasting truth here at Leicester, it is that human rights, liberty, and the rule of law are intimately intertwined. You now become its guardians. You leave also here as alumni and alumni of the University of Leicester, and so you shall be for the rest of your days. But we in turn will continue to take a keen interest in your progress, in your successes. The achievements of the graduates of university shine on the reputation of the university itself, and your successes will be shared here as ours. Above all, celebrate your success today. You've earned it. But may I wish you, even beyond success, health and happiness in the years to come. Thank you. I now declare this congregation closed.